would feel that we aren't truly in a bear market, but can you revisit the idea of the super cycle?
Yeah, it's funny. As soon as there's a little bit of a dip, you know, people lose faith. And so I think of the quote, you know, "Oh ye of little faith." I've been hodling for 9 years and three different bull runs. And so folks, the first big dip in a bull run, people are like, "It's over, it's over." And, you know, this very much reminds me of 2013. You know, 2013, we had a bull run in the beginning of the year. Then it had this sideways agonizing chop for about 3 to 6 months. And then we had a bull run at the end of the year. And so this year very much feels like that. Now, to zoom out and apply this knowledge to what the super cycle means, the super cycle is basic. The TLDR is that this time is different and that it probably won't, Bitcoin probably won't behave like all the other cycles. And I think this skews more bullish. Now, of course, no one can predict the future, neither you nor I can, you know, so as a caveat, these are more of just our opinions on where the price might go. So the super cycle is basically like this time is different. We have institutions, we have institutional infrastructure. We have the whole world coming to understand Bitcoin's value prop. Bitcoin is available to purchase in like Cash App, Robinhood, SoFi, PayPal, Venmo, alongside Kraken, Coinbase, et cetera. There's so many places to buy it. And there's so much good knowledge and educational content that Bitcoin could go from 100 million users to a billion users potentially, or something really big like that. So the super cycles basically dictates this time is different. We could see it be more bullish than usual. And what that would look like would be kind of like a 2013 where we have a mini bull run and then another bull run later in the year. Or we would see that kind of like a longer, more extended bull run where maybe there's a muted bear market, right? Like the bear market isn't as intense. Now with this dip in the middle, I don't know if that part of my thesis or that interpretation of my thesis holds true anymore, you know, in terms of there being a more mild bear market. It seems like this market is still very intense and we saw a pretty big dip here on the way up. So yeah, TLDR overall, it's basically a more bullish interpretation on this current cycle that, you know, this is the moment that mainstream wakes up and institutions wake up and believe that Bitcoin is valuable. And if that happens, then Bitcoin's not going to have a normal bull run.
I think it's all also a matter of time frame and interpretation, because you look at Bitcoin March of 2020 at 3,800, or even call it 6,000, since it was very temporarily under 4,000. And you look at a price of 29,000, which was basically the lows of this quote unquote bear market, you would have killed for that price when Bitcoin was 6,000.
Totally. Totally. It's so funny how bearish people get when they see Bitcoin at 30,000. They're like, oh man, that was capitulation, right? Like right under 30. It's so funny to think about that. Bitcoin exposes so much of the raw human nature of fear and greed, where Bitcoin's price, nothing changed about Bitcoin. The price just changed. But because of that, people have these mental models of what's expensive or cheap. And so it totally, you know, flips the idea of like, what is value and how do people value things on top of its head? It's really interesting to see.
I've made that argument countless times that price and value are not the same thing. And I think new traders and investors don't understand that. And obviously they're drawn to whatever the price is at that moment and they determine it as such. But when you look at on-chain metrics, the central banks, I mean, all of the reasons that we buy Bitcoin, I think it's a very clear argument that the price is not caught up to the value.
Totally. I mean, look, Bitcoin, if the world realized Bitcoin's value, Bitcoin should be at $10 to $100 trillion market cap. I mean, that's what Bitcoin's true net worth is in terms of like, if we look at gold or other store of value assets. I mean, there's $18 trillion of bonds in the world that is negatively yielding. I mean, that doesn't even make sense. It's like the credit card company paying you to take out a loan and then they pay you every single month because you borrowed from them. I mean, it's absurd. So, you know, Bitcoin, I think, especially in this environment, Bitcoin should be worth at least tens of trillions. So yeah, we're very far away from that.
Interestingly, I mean, we obviously talk about inflation and the potential for hyperinflation and negative bond yields. Kathy Wood today said she views deflation as a much bigger threat than inflation at the moment.
Yeah, I don't know about that. I mean, money printer go burr is pretty insane right now. And I think a lot of the worries around deflation are unfounded. In fact, if you look at the number of times the word deflation is used, so like right after the Federal Reserve was created through the Great Depression, that word became this piece of FUD for the former, you know, pre-central bank era of like, oh, there's these deflationary spirals. There's all these issues with deflation. Oh no, deflation, it's going to end the world. Well, why is inflation okay, but deflation's not okay? And there's all sorts of bizarre arguments that economists come up with as to why deflation's bad. One of the most absurd ones is that, oh, well, as prices decrease, consumers will withhold spending in perpetuity because they expect prices to continue to decrease, which doesn't make any sense. It's saying that humans don't consume anything and that they'll be able to withhold like spending on food and housing for forever.
It's a presumption that you will wait 2 years to eat because prices might go down.
Exactly. It's a classic economist style of thought, right? Like totally, you know, theory ready, but nothing applicable to the real world. And also, you know, let's zoom out and look at real world examples of where that isn't the case. TVs and electronics, TVs continually drop in price and have higher and higher quality. Huh. Why are people buying TVs? Well, because they want to consume content right now. They don't want to wait 5 years and withhold consumption. This whole deflation worry, I think, is really overblown. And if we look at the word frequency done by Google Ngram, so Google Ngram looks at the frequency of words across all the books in their corpus. If we look at the word deflation, it really spiked around the Great Depression post Fed being created. And it became this boogeyman. Became this boogeyman where inflation fights deflation. And it's this boogeyman that they must constantly fight against. But in reality, the market would just equilibrate. It would just equalize. There's nothing wrong with inflation or deflation. It's just the market reacting to certain conditions. And so, yeah, I think deflation is a really big boogeyman that's often used as this concern, but I don't think it's a concern at all.
I've had Jeff Booth on the podcast twice. Well, his book, The Price of Tomorrow, is one of my favorites. And in a vacuum, deflation, a deflationary environment is actually somewhat biblical heaven, right? I mean, people don't have to work as much. Goods are cheaper. You go about your day and become an entrepreneur and enjoy your free time.
Yeah, it's funny. Like anyone who argues for inflation typically doesn't have a very good argument for deflation in terms of like why they're against it. They're just like, oh, it's bad.
Yeah, the sweeping idea that it's bad.
Well, so, in a classic one, like you ask your economics professor at your university, they're going to say a deflationary spiral. It's a classic term.
Yeah.
Remember during the 2018, 2019 era in Bitcoin where people talked about the Bitcoin miner death spiral?
Yeah.
It's funny to see these narratives repackaged in this FUD repackaged and slapped onto Bitcoin or any other topic. It's, the word spiral is often used to connotate this like building upon itself negativity that occurs, but we don't see that in practice at all.
Right. And Bitcoin's never had a spiral of that sort. Even though price has corrected, the mining thing, FUD. China, always FUD. India, always FUD. Ransomware, always FUD. Environmental impact, always FUD. It never spirals.
Yeah, it's funny. I people act like that miners won't care about economic interest and that like the market won't equilibrate. And I'm like, well, of course it will, since the market, like there's strong incentive for it to equalize. I just did a presentation at an investment firm. And at the end, I had this rapid fire FUD. So I presented the piece of FUD and then debunked it. And after being 9 years in this space, it gets pretty damn tiring where you're like, okay, the China FUD has been around for a long time. And now that Bitcoin miners are out of China, I bet you will still see China FUD. I bet you will still see it. It'll be ridiculous because they're out of China and China has very limited, Bitcoin economic activity now, but we'll still see China FUD.
China FUD will never end. If we have one narrative that returns every time price drops by at least 10%, it's something to do with China.
Death, taxes, and FUD. Remember, like the only the three constants in life.